Andrew here, here we are again. This is episode 28 and it's day 24 of our national lockdown. Could be coming to an end soon, at least at this stage. This morning we're continuing in Matthew's Gospel in chapter 10. We're going to be looking today at verses 26 through to 31. Yesterday we considered the likelihood of opposition that the apostles would face as they went out to declare and to demonstrate the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus has quite a bit to say about that, and that this could be really unpleasant. And so we actually considered the question of whether we're actually entitled to expect that because we're followers of Jesus that everything is just going to go swimmingly. So today we're going to pick up the text at verse 26 of chapter 10. So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the rooftops. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Fear him, rather, who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Today, the reasons for the opposition are made clearer. The reality is that we as human beings don't like exposure. We have a great thing in the West about privacy. We don't actually want people to know and to see what we're doing and what we're up to. And we don't want it to be exposed either publicly or in the quiet of our own hearts. And we like it even less when those who are calling us out appear to have no faults, no defects, no sin. It seems to me that we live in an age, and I suspect that this probably hasn't changed too much, where we prefer our heroes to have all of these things. Faults, defects, obvious sin. We want them to be like us. We do not want them to be perfect. Because them being different simply reinforces the distance between us. And it accentuates our own sense of inferiority and unworthiness. I remember some years ago that British radio stations stopped playing Cliff Richard songs. Cliff Richards at the time was wildly popular, particularly with older women. But the radio station stopped playing his songs. And the reason is that they hated the people who chose the songs, hated his goody-two-shoes, his squeaky-clean image. They prefer, as most of us do, our heroes to be a bit more like us, to be damaged, to be obviously a little bit bent out of shape. So when Jesus suggests that nothing is covered that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not be known, will not become known, this is likely to fill guilty hearts with a measure of anxiety, especially if within those hearts there is no desire to change, and people want to keep on doing exactly as they have been. The last thing they want is to be made to feel guilty. Jesus, on the other hand, goes on to reassure the disciples that they do not need to fear the hatred of others. And it's interesting that it's the opinion of other people that often matters deeply to us, even strangers. We care about what they think. Yet, as Jesus points out, ultimately each one of us lives before an audience of one. And the view of us, of this one, is the only view that matters. So Jesus then goes on to assure his disciples there and us that God's position on us is settled. This audience of one, his position is settled. This audience of one sees us as we are, knows us much better than we imagine we know ourselves. And as I've said before, is never caught by surprise. This audience of one is never going to turn toward us and say, "Oh, if I'd known that about you, if I'd realized that was who you really are, I'd never have poured out my love towards you, never have called you into a life walking with me." This audience of one is never going to say that, is never going to think it, is never going to change his mind about us. It's reassuring to know that. I'm inviting you to embrace that thought, that reality today. Jesus reassures us also of this laying out of God's love and tender concern for the whole creation with these words. We read them, we'll repeat them. In verse 29, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So don't be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows." It seems to me that we're given cause for boldness. If we took this seriously, we could be confident of God's love and concern for us, for God watching over us, whatever happens. And knowing that nothing could separate us from that love. How might we live if we had such a deep assurance? With what boldness and confidence might be the hallmarks of our daily encounter with the world and with life itself? If we were able to embrace the knowing of how profoundly and deeply we are loved by God. And how much God cares about us. Paul, in his letter to the Ephesians, echoes this in a slightly different way, yet picks up the essence of what Jesus is saying. Paul prays two great prayers in this letter. Prayers which I believe reflect God's heart in the same way that the words of Jesus here reflect God's heart. And I pray these two prayers daily. I pray them for myself and for the people of Opawa. It's the second of these two that I particularly want to look at today, just briefly. So Paul says this. This is his prayer in Ephesians 3, verse 14. And this passage goes right through to verse 21, but we'll finish it at verse 19 and pick up the last two verses at the end. "For this reason," says Paul, "I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name." And here's the prayer. Verse 16, "I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God." Imagine what our lives might look like if we took this prayer seriously. If we took hold of God's view in love for us. If we knew with that deep knowing how deeply loved we are by God, how profound the action of Christ within us could be. Paul seems to have a handle on this. It's his yearning, a reflection, I believe, of the yearning of the Holy Spirit, that we all have a handle on this, that we all have a deep awareness deep within us of how effective, how efficacious, how profoundly real the love of Christ for us is, that we need fear nothing. What a difference it would make in our lives and in the lives ultimately of those around us. Paul also recognizes how far we are so often from this revelation of God's love. We continue to doubt it. We look at ourselves as being small and unworthy and unlovable. And we rarely step up to the plate of embracing and knowing ourselves embraced by that love of Christ. So I'll leave you with the blessing that follows immediately after the prayer that we've read. And there's one that I often use, and I'm sure there's used by churches all around the world, simply as a form of blessing. But it comes right after this prayer, and so I'll finish with this today. In verse 20, "Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to God be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. 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 Amen.